HIV 2020 Online Closing Plenary. Before we begin, we have a couple of announcements for you. Please access interpretation through Zoom. Please choose the audio channel for the language of your choice by selecting interpretation and then the language. You can mute original audio to only hear the interpreter. HIV 2020 Online is a safe and neutral space for the sharing of knowledge, experience, skills, and opinions in a mutually respectful manner. We operate on a zero tolerance policy for any kind of bullying, harassment, abusive use of language, aggressive expression of opinions, or any undesirable behaviors. If you do have such behaviors, we will be able to immediately remove you from this session with no prior notice. Please also note that this session is live streamed on Facebook and is recorded and will be uploaded to the HIV YouTube channel. Please use the Q&A function to interact with the speakers. You can post your comments and questions there as well as upload comments and reply to comments and questions by other speakers. And with that, thank you for joining us for the closing plenary of HIV 2020 Online, a four-month virtual conference led by and organized with key populations and community-led organizations, networks, and groups. My name is Rachel Long, and I am based in Singapore, the HIV 2020 Online Conference Coordinator Lead, and I have the privilege and honor to be your host for the closing plenary. On the 33rd World AIDS Day since it was first founded in August 1987, the theme Ending the HIV/AIDS Epidemic, Resilience and Impact has never been even more true in this year, where COVID-19 has impacted the work that we all do. So thank you, all of you, for joining us today in solidarity on such a special day as we have learned to work together even more closely and collaboratively, even though we are physically apart. So before we begin with the closing plenary, I would like to introduce Friedal Dausab. He's a board member from GNP Plus to share a few words and light a candle so that we may observe a moment of silence. Friedal, please switch on your video.
Thank you, Rachel. And welcome to everyone. Shortly, I will lead us into lighting a candle. If you have one near you, please have it ready. This year marks World AIDS Day in the midst of a new global pandemic that has claimed the lives of more than a million around the world. And we extend our solidarity to all families who have lost a loved one. It is fitting that we mark the closing of HIV 2020 Online with a moment of silence to remember and honor the many comrades we have lost. I come from a region where HIV, in the early days of the HIV epidemic, we spent our weekends burying friends and loved ones. As I light my candle, let us all together dedicate our collective work as communities leading the HIV response to our comrades who are no longer here with us to lead the struggle. Join me in a minute of silence. Thank you, everyone. I will now hand back to Rachel.
Thanks so much, Friedal. And thank you for remembering the ones that passed before us and also celebrate the gains that we have made this year collectively within the COVID-19 pandemic. So the closing plenary of HIV 2020 Online is meant for us to celebrate the advancements we have as key stakeholders in the HIV response, looking at our achievements, and at the same time, be very cognizant of the gaps, challenges, and barriers that are in our way. We are joined by distinguished guests and speakers from the donors, technical partners, key populations, and communities, as well as a recap video that we will show that will have key moments that we have shared all together in the last 4 months. We also have a surprise guest that has joined us for closing remarks, so please stay tuned. So without further ado, I will introduce Laurel, Dr. Laurel Sprague, who is the Chief Community Mobilization at UNAIDS headquarters in Geneva, Switzerland. She has worked with and for and as part of communities of people living with HIV and key populations since 1991. She started through peer support groups and then working with networks of people living with HIV, advocacy organizations, and community-led research initiatives. So this was done from local to regional and now at the global level. She has previously held positions with the Global Network of People Living with HIV, the HIV Justice Network, and the Sarah Project, and taught political science to undergraduates and graduate students in metropolitan Detroit. She holds a PhD in political theory. So without further ado, let us welcome Laurel.
Hello, colleagues. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here with you today, especially on World AIDS Day. And I just want to congratulate the organizers of HIV 2020 before I start on really an incredibly successful virtual conference that has been meaningful and instructive for me and for, I know, the hundreds or more of other people who have been part of this conference. So congratulations. I wonder if we could start the PowerPoint that I sent. I've been asked to speak today on something that's very dear to my heart and probably to many of yours, on the work to promote responses led by and for communities. And if we could go to the next slide, I just wanted to first acknowledge again that it is World AIDS Day and to recognize and appreciate those people that have paved the way for us. That started the networks. Most of the people who started the networks that we are part of are now gone, but really their work lives on through us and through this work that we're doing. So really offering appreciation to their memory and hoping that we're carrying on their work with the right spirit, love, and intention. So please go to the next slide. So the work on community-led responses focuses, of course, on the work that we know very well, the people on this conference call today. This is the work that is done by networks of people living with HIV, including women's networks and young people's networks of sex workers, networks of transgender people, networks of people who use drugs, networks of gay men and other men who have sex with men. Please excuse my dog. And all of the other really key self-empowerment movements or work that we have done together to support ourselves as peers and move the HIV response forward to meet the needs of people that we know people need because we come from those groups of people ourselves. I just wanted to note with this opening slide that when we're talking about community-led HIV responses, there are a whole lot of different kinds of responses that fit within this category. So it's an umbrella term that includes service delivery, advocacy, monitoring, participatory research, engagement in governance and decision-making bodies, the GIPA work that we all do, and more. It's all the work that is led by and for communities. Next slide, please. So how are we doing? There was another half of this slide. I'll tell you what it said so that I don't see it here. In the work to monitor political commitments to support community-led responses, I want to talk for a minute about how we're doing. And if we go to the next slide, what I want to say is first that we have two commitments from the last political declaration in 2016 that relate to community-led responses. So in 2016, at the UN high-level meeting on ending AIDS, UN member states committed to ensure that at least 30% of all service delivery would be community-led by 2030, and that at least 6% of HIV resources would be allocated for social enabling activities, which include community mobilization and a number of the activities that are best led and generally led by and for communities ourselves. So these are, right now, the commitments that we have from UN member states to include and support communities in the HIV response. So please go to the next slide. And what you see here in short is that we're not doing a very good job monitoring those commitments because we don't have the data we need to know what kind of progress is being made. And one of the reasons, and perhaps a primary reason that we're not able to monitor this response is that we don't have shared definitions of what is meant by community-led responses or community-led organizations. So go to the next slide. So what we have done at UNAIDS with the global key population networks, PLHIV networks, women and TB networks, is to do the work to draft a definition that could be used globally, a standard definition of what is a community-led response. Also, what is a key population-led response? And we're now doing work currently with women's organizations to define what is a women-led response. And this is really critical. It's really critical that this work come from communities themselves, because communities are the ones implementing community-led responses and need to be the first to set down the language of what is a community-led response and what is not a community-led response. So there are some other groups working, including a multi-stakeholder task team that has been called together by UNAIDS that includes UN member states as well as civil society to work on these definitions and to promote better funding for community-led responses. The fundamental work is being done by communities themselves. And if we could go to the next slide, I'm going to show you definitions that have been drafted and are close to fully supported now. These definitions come from a meeting that was referenced on the previous slide last year in 2019 that brought together the heads of and members of the global networks, global key population HIV networks, women's networks, the PCB NGO delegation from UNAIDS, and the communities delegation from Global Fund, plus a new organization called TB People, made up of people living with and affected by TB. So this group came together last year and drafted this definition, which has only changed slightly from their original formulation. And I think it's really important to spend a moment with this definition itself, because there are some key things that need to happen for this definition to work. And if you haven't been involved in the definitional work, just if you could take a step back for a minute and think, how are we going to differentiate for funding, support, visibility, and more? How are we going to differentiate which organizations are community-led and which may be really good organizations and do good work and maybe are important in other ways, but are not community-led organizations? What are the key factors that make something led by communities? And here's the definition that came forward, which is that these organizations can be formally or informally organized. They may or may not be legally registered, but they are entities that have the majority of people who are involved, the governance, leadership, staff, membership, et cetera. But the majority of people, more than half, come from the community itself. And that these organizations have transparent mechanisms of accountability to their constituencies, that these are self-determining autonomous organizations, not influenced by government, commercial, and donor agendas, and that simply because something is based in a community does not mean that it's community-led. So that's a key distinction. We could go to the next slide, please. So that slide defined, the previous slide defined community-led organizations, who it is that conducts community-led responses. This slide looks at what happens, what kind of work would qualify as a community-led response. And it focuses on actions and strategies to improve the health and human rights of the constituencies of community-led organizations. So to be really clear, we're talking about people living with HIV in older diversity, sex workers, people who use drugs, transgender people, gay men and other men who have sex with men, also networks and organizations of adolescent girls and young women, particularly in high prevalence settings. So these are the community-led organizations that we're talking about. They conduct these responses. These responses need to be informed and implemented by and for the communities themselves. These are determined by and responding to the needs and aspirations of the constituents of these organizations. And then you see a list of the kinds of activities that would be included: advocacy, service delivery, capacity building, and more.
Also, there's a note that community-led responses can take place at the global, regional, national, subnational, and grassroots level. And these can be implemented virtually, like through HIV 2020, or in person. And again, not everything that takes place in a community is led by a community. Oh, apologies, I will move more slowly. Okay, next slide, please. So I want to now show the definitions that were drafted by the key population participants in the meeting in which these definitions were created. So people who did not belong to the key populations left to allow the key population networks to self-define these organizations. These have since been taken forward by UNAIDS and others as the key definitions to be used. So key population-led networks and organizations are led by people living with HIV, female, male, and transgender sex workers, gay men and other men who have sex with men, people who use drugs, and transgender people. And this is rooted in the shared experiences of stigma, discrimination, criminalization, and violence. And key population networks share the burden, the disproportionate HIV disease burden in all parts of the world. And then we look again at this numerical definition, that if an organization or network is to be considered to be key population led, then the majority of the people involved in that organization, from governance all the way down to through volunteers and staff people, that the majority of people come from the key population themselves. And the key population led organizations and networks, their work is and priorities are based in lived experience. And the key populations must speak for themselves as an intrinsic and central part of the global HIV response. Next slide, please. And now we look again at the response section. What do key population-led organizations do that qualify as responses for this work? First of all, noting that key populations are intrinsic to the global HIV response. Again, that the responses led by key populations are transformational and based on key population priorities, needs, and rights. That key populations should be included on their own terms or our own terms, as written, with consideration to all of the varying social and structural determinants at all levels of the global HIV response. And that these responses are designed to strengthen community capacities and that they are committed to action. And we know that these responses move forward irrespective of resource availability. Also noted that key population communities are overlapping and therefore the responses strive to be intersectional. And critically, key populations choose their own representatives and how to engage in HIV, gender, human rights, and development related processes. Okay, the next slide is going to be mostly blank. This is the work we're currently supporting on women-led organizations and responses. So please stay tuned. This work will build on the work already crafted for community-led responses and key population-led responses, so that we are working together to create a cohesive set of definitions that work together and that allow us all to work together to promote strengthened attention to community-led responses and the sub-responses, key population, women, young people, TB, people with TB, et cetera, responses that are part of the overall universe of community-led responses. Next slide, please. Okay, so the text isn't here, but this is about the way forward. So let's go to the next slide. So just briefly, there are a few things I wanted to emphasize for this group in terms of how these definitions are being used and what we can expect for next steps. So first of all, you may be familiar with the global AIDS monitoring that happens annually where national authorities report on the global AIDS response and progress in the global AIDS response to UNAIDS. Last year, working with a number of the key population network leaders who are here on this call, we developed and piloted indicators to measure what percentage of prevention activities for key populations were led by key population networks in each country. What I can tell you is that it was positive in that a couple dozen countries responded. So we were able to get responses, but we learned some things about how to word the question better. So we didn't get data that's particularly useful last year. we learned from it. And so we will take these questions forward again in 2020, and hopefully we'll get much stronger data to tell us what percentage of responses for sex workers are led by sex workers in each country, and for gay men are led by gay men in each country, and the same for every key population group. Next slide, please. So then the other new area that I wanted to focus in on, another opportunity to focus on, is that UNAIDS is currently leading the work to develop the next global AIDS strategy for 2021 to 2026. We have proposed to the board that there be a new result area included in this strategy that is specifically on community-led HIV responses that would then emphasize, highlight, and promote the need to scale up community-led HIV responses in every country in the world in order to meet the new UNAIDS targets, 95, 95, 95 targets. And next slide, which is the final one. Just also to share the global AIDS strategy timeline, we expect to have a finalized version of the global AIDS strategy in the first quarter of next year, probably toward the end of March. In April of next year, we will have a new proposed monitoring framework with additional indicators included on community-led responses that should be, hopefully will be adopted and then reported on in every country. And at this point, we are anticipating a high-level meeting in June of next year. And with that high-level meeting will be a new political declaration. The global AIDS strategy currently being developed should form the foundation of this new political declaration. And I really want to urge all of us to work together to do everything we can to make sure that commitments to community-led responses in all their diversity for HIV, in all the diversity of HIV communities, I should say, that those responses have a prominent place in this declaration. And then my final slide is just a slide to say thank you from all of us at UNAIDS, certainly from me to the members of the technical advisory expert group who drafted these initial definitions, and these groups are listed here, and also to the UN member state civil society members and partners who are serving on the UNAIDS multi-stakeholder task team on community-led AIDS responses. Thank you very much. Rachel, back to you.
Thanks so much, Laurel. And it sounds like 2021 is going to be an exciting year, and one that's going to be centered around key population as we further define some of the work and the definitions to make the global strategy work even better. I'm noting that there are a lot of synergies with what will be going into these definitions because it makes and impacts funding streams, as we know that the Global Fund is also developing their Global Fund strategy. So we have next with us a very distinguished speaker, Ambassador Pascale Waltenhouse, to join us today as our keynote speaker. Ambassador Pascale is the Ambassador for Women's Rights and Gender Equality and the Director of Social Development of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Netherlands. Ambassador has joined the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 2001 and was formerly the Dutch Ambassador to Mozambique, the coordinator on the Millennium Development Goals and Partnership, and has worked at the Africa Directorate, Embassy London, and Foreign and Commonwealth Office. So, Ambassador, over to you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me, and congratulations to the organization for putting the attention to solidarity and responsibility today. That is global solidarity and global responsibility. And I think it's very much needed to get the HIV response back on track to ending the HIV pandemic by 2030. It's my pleasure to speak to you today. I think that the current COVID crisis shows why solidarity and responsibility matter. As with HIV/AIDS, its heaviest blows fall on the most marginalized and vulnerable communities. And this in turn places a great stain on health and community systems, which makes fighting pandemics even more difficult. Whether as a global community or as individual countries, our best response to any pandemic is a strong and inclusive health system and resilient communities capable of absorbing shocks. This is true of COVID and it's true of HIV/AIDS. How can we end the HIV pandemic or any pandemic if we ignore the people most at risk? Stigma and criminalization impede access to medical services. which is exactly how pandemics continue to spread. We need to show solidarity with people most at risk, helping the communities, as the previous speaker also said, to find solutions that work for them. And that is why the Netherlands engages with governments, the UN, international networks, and civil society to shape the global health agenda. In our development cooperation, we opt to be pragmatic, look for evidence-based solutions that are anchored in the human rights principle. To put it in short, we invest in what we know that works, which is why the Netherlands strongly supports gender equality, human rights, sexual and reproductive health and rights, and an open civic space through our investments. We think the role of civil society is crucial for well-functioning democracy and inclusive societies, and crucial for achieving SDG 3, good health and well-being, and SDG 5, gender equality. An example on how we engage with civil society is our support to the partnerships Bridging the Gaps and Pitch, and also Hands Off. They are HIV response partnerships that focus on the health and human rights of key populations. And maybe going back a little bit to my time in Mozambique, I spent some time with these partnerships, and I vividly remember the conversations I had with the key populations. And I remember the evening, actually, I spent with sex workers. Although sex work is not criminalized in Mozambique, the way they dressing indiscreetly or assaults on public decently, are punishable by law. So sex workers face a lot of violence, stigmatization, discrimination, and human rights violations. So they are much more vulnerable to HIV and AIDS. And many of them also don't receive the right treatment. The program that I visited secured a national initiative responsive for addressing gender-based violence and protecting the rights of the sex workers. And I vividly remember that the police actually got trained into the rights, what are the rights of sex workers and how should we respect those rights. And I also know that there was a hotline where people could call to talk about the violence against them. So I was really, really impressed. So the partnerships I know from Maputo are key population, community-led and rights-based programs that are striving to end AIDS among key populations. We recognize that biomedical approaches alone do not suffice to reach those groups that are hit hardest by the epidemic. The ministry utilizes its partnerships as a way to strengthen the role of civil society to ensure that those communities most marginalized have equal access to opportunities, resources, and basic human rights, including, of course, the rights to health. The COVID crisis painfully shows that it is the marginalized communities that are hit hardest in health crises, as is the case with the HIV pandemic. The best response, and the only response, is investment in strong and inclusive health systems and in the communities themselves. Our policy includes a continued commitment to sexual and reproductive health and rights, including the HIV/AIDS response. In addition, we work from a growing recognition that leadership will have to shift from the north to the south to those communities that are directly affected. Local leadership and ownership is therefore a key dimension in the new phase of partnerships with civil society starting in 2021. We recognize that AIDS can only be ended through a relentless focus on those communities that are hit hardest, and meaningful involvement of those communities in the response is proven to be essential. But funding for HIV/AIDS is not sufficient to end the epidemic. Other sectors need to come on board to address the underlying root causes. The pandemic of inequality, stigma, and discrimination needs to be tackled by a broad range of sectors and actors. AIDS funding alone cannot solve it. We need to look ahead as well. How can we make our HIV investments more sustainable? What are the options for transitioning to domestic funding? It is a very complex debate. There are no clear and simple answers, but we need to have this dialogue now. By complementing our investment through UNAIDS and the Global Fund with strategic partnerships with civil society, the Netherlands continues to reach groups that are otherwise left out, leave no one behind, and build on its track record of recognizing the intrinsic connection between human rights and health, which is especially central in reaching and engaging often criminalized key populations. We cannot end the epidemic if we leave out the most at risks. Minister Kaas called at the launch of the UNAIDS World AIDS Report in 2020 for the UNAIDS sponsors to strongly support the implementation of the new UNAIDS strategy. UNAIDS co-sponsor and governments each other have their role to play in reaching the 2025 targets, ending punitive law and policies, stigma and discrimination, and gender equality and violence. It calls for a people-centered approach and for removing the barriers faced by marginalized populations, for solidarity with those who are at risk, and for measures to support communities in their response. I echo this call. We have to invest in community-led and right-based responses if we want to achieve our joint goal to end AIDS. It's the only way. Having invested in civil society and community-led initiatives of the last decade, the Dutch government experienced the value added of the HIV civil society firsthand. We know that the civil society contributes directly to strengthening the health systems. The HIV/AIDS civil society bring communities to the health clinic. They ensure health services in the clinics that are relevant to all the patients. They hold governments accountable for their health policies and decisions, and they lead on innovations by bringing the private sector, for instance, on board. Today's World AIDS Day puts the attention to global solidarity and a global responsibility. The Netherlands government is your partner, and I wish you a great conference today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ambassador. Reducing poverty and social inequality is definitely one of the four overarching Dutch development cooperation and policy goals. And we're very glad to hear you talk about how that is so important to the work of your government, and that human rights, as well as gender equality and empowerment of women and girls, which is a cross-cutting goal, is a central theme in your investments and in your principles of the Netherlands. So thank you so much for your time, and we hope you'll stay on and with us. And I'm going to encourage all those that have just joined us, including our colleagues and friends that might be joining us through the live stream that's taking place on Facebook, to please participate and engage with each other. On the Zoom platform, using the Q&A function, you can comment, ask questions to the panelists, and interact with each other through upvoting and or commenting on each other's comments and questions. If you're joining us on Facebook, please leave your message in the comments section and we'll get back to you. So this next segment, we'll have reflections from each one of the core group members of the co-organizers that are from GNP Plus, NSWP, INPUD, and MPact. So let us start off with the reflections from Ruth. Let us start off with reflections from Friedal. Friedal, you've seen and heard just now from GNP Plus. He's a board member and a passionate advocate for evidence-based and human rights-based approaches in the HIV prevention, treatment and care, and he is from Namibia. He currently works as a humanitarian aid worker with UNFPA with a special focus on sexual and reproductive health and gender-based violence in emergency settings. So over to you, Friedal.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. And as a board member of GNP Plus, I'm honored to join Ruth, Judy, and Mohan in this closing plenary of what has been a historic international conference. As they will no doubt tell you, this idea may have started as a protest, but it grew to become something so much more. We establish communities of people living with HIV and key populations of international conferences. From decision making to participation, we have shown that we as communities can achieve what we can show when we come together and reclaim the response with networks to design and powerful international. We were amongst the first to go online and we brought creativity to that space. But leadership, solidarity, and creativity by communities is not the only thing that set this conference apart. We discussed issues that matter. We heard and shared our lived experiences of stigma, of discrimination, and of violence. All this because our HIV status, or because we use drugs, we do sex work, or we are gay or transgender. Session after session called out criminalization and harmful gender norms. We heard calls for bodily integrity and for ending stigma and for HIV justice. Many sessions demonstrated the intersectionality of our movements, recognizing that as people, we just don't have one identity or one priority. And time and again, we heard the call, where is the money? Where is the money for prevention? Where is the money for community organizing? Where is the money for community-led monitoring and accountability? And most importantly, where is the money for key populations and key population-led networks and responses? As GNP Plus, we believe that HIV 2020 did best to consolidate the principle of GIPA, the greater involvement of people living with HIV, and it clearly showed what a community-led response looks like. At HIV 2020, communities did reclaim the response, and I hope that the donors and governments were watching. I thank you. Over to you, Rachel.
Great, thank you so much, Friedal, and sorry about that. I was talking and obviously I was on mute. I'm trying to run two devices at the same time. Thank you so much. Apologies, I had to switch off your video because the bandwidth was causing problems and you were a lot clearer after we switched off your video. So thank you for that. Thank you so much. And next we have Ruth. Ruth is the global coordinator for NSWP. And she has been one of the founding members of NSWP in 1992 and has been employed as their global coordinator since 2010. She has been in the sex work industry for more than 40 years, 8 years as a full-time sex worker, 2.5 years as an academic researcher looking at HIV-related risks in the sex industry, and more than 30 years as a sex workers' rights advocate, campaigning for, developing, and maintaining services and support for sex workers within a human rights framework. So, Ruth, over to you.
Thank you, Rachel, and greetings to everyone from Scotland. It's been our honour as NSWP to co-organise this event with GMP Plus, INPUD, and MPact. And it's my pleasure to join everyone in this final session of HIV 2020 Online, where we share some of the highlights of the past 4 months. HIV 2020 has been both a celebration and a protest, holding up the light to our community's expertise, knowledge, and lived experience that are so crucial to the HIV response. Our communities have demonstrated how truly amazing we are. HIV 2020 Online has been a remarkable and inspiring journey. We have shown what meaningful involvement of key populations and communities can bring to the HIV response. We have amplified the voices of our communities as experts in their own lives. We have shown what a commitment to leaving no one behind can achieve. We have celebrated our diversity while standing in solidarity with one another. We have shown both resistance and resilience throughout HIV 2020. We have challenged the powers that be, who chose to ignore us, so that they listen to our voices and experiences. We have sought to open their eyes and their minds to the opportunities that exist if they are willing to share and shift power. We will continue to invite those in power to embrace dissent and challenge, and we invite them to enter into meaningful conversation with us. We will continue to challenge business as usual. We will continue to invite those in power to reflect on the potential of truly partnering with our communities as we reclaim the response. We thank everyone who participated in HIV 2020 Online again for your commitment, your energy, and your willingness to walk this path with us. Thank you. And back to you, Rachel.
Thanks so much, Ruth. Next, we have with us Judy. Judy is the Executive Director for the International Network of People Who Use Drugs, and she's based in Italy. She has an extensive experience and has worked across different countries in India, in China, and in Thailand. So over to you now, Judy.
Thanks, Rachel. And first, guest, just want to say how pleased I am on behalf of INPUD to be here at the closing ceremony after a 4-month-long journey. So firstly, yes, I just wanted to say that HIV 2020 and emphasize that it was the first alternate community-led HIV conference, and really to celebrate that. It was truly a co-created global platform by and for key population communities. It was always going to be an ambitious undertaking, and personally my first experience of being on the back end of a large-scale conference. For me, I think, you know, it seemed from the beginning, you know, communities have always been underestimated, but HIV 2020 was a game changer, particularly with the onset of COVID and all the additional pressures it put on communities around the world, as well as on the conference itself. But, you know, communities were present, engaged despite all these global challenges and new global challenges. We were one of the first conferences that really met that challenge and adhered to the principles all throughout of ensuring that the conference remained as accessible as possible to our communities, who really bear the brunt of broken policies and political agendas and that are so often left behind in national, regional, and global dialogues. So, you know, as other speakers have also spoken about, we really did challenge business as usual, making all sessions and public communications available across 5 languages, which was no mean feat, retaining, you know, our commitments to the original sessions, including art and performances, and keeping the decision-making and organizing throughout in the hands of communities. Each session was really vibrant, colorful, and engaging. And, you know, none of them ever reduced us to numbers and statistics, nor diminished deeply entrenched problems by proposing biomedical solutions that don't, you know, that ignore the context, the political and social context in which we're operating, nor did they ever tokenize our voices. So from INPUD side, we're so grateful to the co-organizers, MPact, NSWP, GNP Plus, and ICSS, to Rachel Naluka as conference organizers for doing such an amazing job. Of course, the dedicated translation team, and to all session organizers and everyone who tuned in, as well as the donors that came along with us on this 4-month journey. It was during this 4-month period of HIV 2020 that we learned that 62% of new HIV cases are amongst key populations and our partners, but that a mere 2% of funding is allocated, as was shared during the Bridging the Gap session on Do the Math campaign, which was also launched during HIV 2020. So just, you know, another stark reminder of the deep, really deep inequalities, you know, we're up against. HIV 2020 was truly proof of concept that we do it better when we do it ourselves, and at a fraction of the price tag. This is not only true for conferences and dialogues, but for services, research, and advocacy. I think, you know, for us, HIV 2020 was really a celebration of the power we have when we work in solidarity. and really demand our right to be heard. I think our message was heard very loud and clear. And that was, you know, if you continue to ignore us, you know, we will create our own platform and we'll create our own loudspeaker. So just in closing, really want to appreciate again everyone who has joined us for the closing session. Of course, we know that the work doesn't end here, but it's a turning point. We do need to keep the pressure up to continue to push for shifting power and the space for community-led voices that I think HIV 2020 has really, renewed and emphasized again to really demand that key population communities remain center stage, because we know it's where we belong. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Judy. And we have created our very own loudspeaker. Next, we have Mohan. Mohan is the Director of Programs and the Interim Executive Director of MPact Global Action for Gay Men's Health and Rights, who's based in California, USA. No idea how you're juggling both at the same time. You have 14 over years of cumulative experience in global health policy and advocacy, program design and implementation. And you're also a classically trained pianist, composer, and music therapist. So share with us your reflections and thoughts. Thank you so much, Mohan.
Thank you, Rachel, and thanks for embellishing my bio. I appreciate that. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, colleagues. I am Mohan Sundararaj, and I'm with MPact Global Action for Gay Men's Health and Rights, one of the proud co-organizers of HIV 2020. Thank you for joining us for the closing session of HIV 2020, and a special thanks to all of the guest speakers who made time to join us today. From MPact's perspective, I would like to emphasize three points that stand out for me personally when I reflect on HIV 2020. Firstly, HIV 2020 was about community leadership. Community members were equal partners alongside researchers and decision makers at HIV 2020. Community advocates had an equal say in the design, implementation, and evaluation of proposed activities. 5 community-led peer review groups were formed to review the 250 proposals we received from around the world. After this, the community-led program working group, which I had the privilege to be a part of, finalized the overall program. Secondly, HIV 2020 was about breaking barriers. HIV 2020 aspired to be a platform that consciously elevated marginalized voices. HIV 2020 did not allow language differences to be a barrier. We supported simultaneous translation, as you can see today, and interpretation in 5 languages: English, French, Portuguese, Spanish, and Russian. The incredible level of attendance at HIV 2020 therefore speaks to the power of large online events that become safe spaces for our communities. It is also a result of careful curation of content that was aligned with community priorities and driven by communities themselves. And finally, HIV 2020 was about working in solidarity with one another. We recognize that an effective global response to HIV is one that embraces unity across our movements. So while we acknowledged our differences and celebrated our amazing diversity, gay and bisexual men, people who use drugs, sex workers, transgender people, and people living with HIV stood together and courageously spoke truth to power. In the words of my friend, George Ayala, who envisioned and truly championed HIV 2020 on MPact's behalf, we modeled for the world a new way of working without having to leave parts of ourselves at the door. We are reclaiming the global HIV response. And finally, my sincere thanks to NSWP, INPUD, GNP Plus, and the conference co-organizers, Rachel and Niluka, our generous sponsors and donors, the incredible range of presenters from around the world, the translation team, rapporteurs, volunteers, thousands of participants, and last but not least, the wonderful team here at MPact for ensuring that HIV was a successful community-led event. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mohan. And so we move on to remembering what the last 4 months were actually like for all of us. And with that, I have with us Niluka Pereira, who you've been hearing the name a lot, actually, by our previous speakers. So Niluka is actually based in Colombo in Sri Lanka. His full-time job is actually the Communications and Coordination Officer with the Global Fund Advocates Network Asia Pacific, a very dear friend and colleague whom I'm working with. So Niluka, over to you before we play the video.
Thanks, Rachel. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. As Rachel said, I'm Niluka, based out of Colombo, Sri Lanka. So joining HIV 2020 as one of the online conference coordinators in June this year was exciting, overwhelming, and at the same time, it was a huge privilege to be part of this first ever conference organized by the community, with the community, for the community. And this also provided me a very new and an intriguing perspective on how, as communities, we can collectively work towards making our voices heard despite all the challenges we have. Since the start of the conference in June, we have developed recap videos for every month, capturing the essence of the sessions that took place in June and in the consecutive months. And as we are at the end of the conference, we have also developed a final recap video capturing the very essence of this conference. As you know, it's actually a celebration of communities and a protest reclaiming the response. We also give a special thanks to Sam Nye and Eugene Cole, our colleagues from Edit and Play, the firm that developed these videos, for their exciting monthly recap videos and for being amazingly cooperative and flexible with us and the co-organizers of the conference. So without any further ado, let's now take a look at what this conference meant, the final recap video of HIV 2020 online.
Come as a surprise to learn that in 2018, only 2% of funding in low and middle income countries reached those communities. It's time to end AIDS. It's time to invest in key populations.
The critical thing we need to do, and this is where I think key populations themselves have to take the lead, is to ensure that we deliver the argument in a compelling way, supported by data, and this report is definitely a step in this direction, that shows convincingly to donors that we will not beat HIV unless we increase spending on key populations.
But we've said it, that we are not on track. We are not on track to achieve the 2020 targets, not on track to end AIDS by 2030. And because we are not putting our effort enough where the epidemic is growing, and that's key populations. We need to rapidly scale up funding for effective HIV programs for key populations. That's clear there.
And if we look at, obviously, at the international generic costs that everyone is probably more familiar with, that you could get if you were, say, in a, you know, did not have these patent exclusivities, the amount of money would literally be thousands of times less, or hundreds of times less. So every single dollar that we are spending on these sort of exorbitant prices means that there's less money here in the US to deal with the other barriers that we have.
I have found the sex work donor collaborative a very useful space to learn from each other and to support each other. But also we have taken the opportunity and we broke the silos when we were meeting weekly regarding the COVID crisis. And we decided indeed, as I mentioned, to amplify the voices of the community. That's what I think, it's not what we can do. That's what I think the role of philanthropy should be.
This is a grassroots response to the drug war, fighting back. important that we value young key affected populations and that we ensure that they're active and valued partners in the political process at all levels.
Introduce ourselves in the community, not just as a vulnerable women, because we are not just that. We want to be part of the neighborhood as part of the solution and not the problem.
And I think that's the key there, is it was with, it wasn't for, it wasn't because of, it was with him.
I want to say any community person can do it. And this is the reason why we have come out very strongly with a new slogan by saying the sex workers do it better. If you do it, then you will do it better because you belong to a community that has done it and we can always keep on doing it.
Porque yo misma me felicito de una mujer que no hablaba, porque es que yo no hablaba. Ahora hasta dar talleres, participar en reuniones, tomar decisiones y el ayudar, que es lo que más me gusta.
We need for this a more activists with open faces, because it's too little of us and we cannot fight on all the front lines in this world. And we have to fight for it every day and let people know in such a troubles we are.
And the thing is that a lot of great activists and people living in HIV, they still don't understand the reality. The reality is, after 40 years of the response, where people are going to jail just because they're HIV positive and they were having sex.
Aboriginal sex workers need anti-discrimination protection against the racism, prejudice and discriminations we face as sex workers and Aboriginal people.
Con los servicios de salud hay que hablar de derechos humanos. Hay que formar a los profesionales en derechos humanos, porque a mí me parece muy bien un profesional que nos atiende, pero realmente no sabe cuáles son los derechos de las personas trans.
We also need like the political willingness also coming from the donors, that we cannot just do our work by ourselves, because how we can fight for our rights if the government itself like try to criminalize us.
A lot of the time it's driven, the oppression of, you know, different bodies is driven by identities of state, as religious, as whatever other forms of fundamentalist, you know, knowledge and ideologies that then limit how they perceive persons and or how they think people need to be.
It is now time for us to join in unison to demand the end of these stigmatizing, retrograde, unproductive, hurtful, harmful laws.
Ten todo lo necesario para que estemos divinas.
Además, me tienes que ayudar a arreglar.
Que los desafíos resultaban donde sea.
HIV virus. While I walk endless journey, I decided to stop hiding behind the mask.
So thank you. Thank you for the kind words that we're seeing online in the chat box, on Zoom, as well as on Facebook around the video. We want to remind you that the video as well as all of our session recordings are also available on the HIV 2020 YouTube channel. So stay tuned. Please go and have a look at the other recap videos. This video will be subtitled and then made available online in all 5 languages of the conference in English, French, Spanish, Portuguese, and Russian in the coming week. And we want to thank again our Edit and Play, the agency that has done this work, given the very short timelines, and also to our translation agency, Tatlin, Olin, for the subtitling in English, given the short time frame. And again, to emphasize all of the collaborations, the work, the efforts behind HIV 2020 have been done from community organizations, even the agencies that have been contracted to do so. So we will move now to hearing from our different representatives that come from the community, from our different key populations, on their thoughts, impressions, and key messages that they bring through the 4 months of HIV 2020 online. So Phelister Abdalla needs no introduction. Phelister, you can switch on your video first. She is the national coordinator of the Kenya Sex Workers Alliance. She is a co-founder of the African Sex Workers Alliance and one of the pioneers of the sex workers movements in Africa. Before she joined KESWA, Phelister worked for ICRH Kenya as a peer educator and zone leader, leading in organizations' advocacy and peer mobilization. So, Phelister, over to you.
Thank you very much, Retro. Thank you so much. Today, as we mark this historic protest and also a celebration for us as key population, one of the things that really came out clearly for me as one of the people who were in several panels and moderating a few sessions, it's the fact that this is a win for us as a community. We have sent a strong message to our partners outside there and tell them that the community does it better and we've always done it better. HIV is not a burden for chosen a few. Many are the times that HIV has been treated like research. HIV has been treated as an academic issue, as an issue that does not belong to communities. And this is the reason why the protest came along. I come from a criminalized population. I am a sex worker in Kenya. It has not been easy to be a sex worker who is living with HIV in my country. One, because of the stigma and discrimination that comes along with it. Two, because of the criminalization part of it. Three, because of the violences that we face as sex workers in Kenya. Sometimes we just want to talk about our lived realities. HIV is a burden. It is really affecting us as a community. I saw HIV 2020 as an opportunity for me to express myself as a community person that comes from the sex work community. It gave me an opportunity of sharing my experiences and sharing my lived realities. It was affordable for us community members because most of the times where we send abstracts, sometimes they are successful and sometimes they are not. But even there are limitations because many opportunities are given to scientists and academics and not really communities. I was happy because I was part of a few panels, because I was able to share my experience. I was able to share what we do in our community. I was able to share what we do as the Kenyan sex workers. Affordability of it made it more beautiful. And it made it a place where we belong as a community. And apart from it just being affordable, it was a space that had a sense of belonging because I looked at my community members taking leadership in many platforms in this HIV 2020, and it was marvelous. when I heard that it was going to be an online platform, why lie? I was like, this is not my expertise. But only to challenge myself more, I only came to realize that we communities can do things that we can never imagine. This is one of those platforms that I really enjoyed presenting and sharing my experiences. One of the things is the fact that, and which has come very clear, is the fact that if we stand together as a community, then there's nothing that we cannot do. We can actually move mountains. I was moderating one of the sessions in the HIV 2020 asking, where is the money for key population? And it was quite surprising that it is only 2% of HIV funding that goes to key population interventions. And in this 2%, it does not show how many percent really goes to community-led interventions. HIV 2020 has given us a platform and it has really opened our eyes as community. It has shown us that unity is not just about talking about it, but also acting on it. We are calling upon the people who are on power today. Want to tell them that we are always open to partner with people who genuinely engage us and make decisions together along with us, but not making decisions and expect us to follow their rule. We will always be open to work with them when they will be ready to work with us. The second message that I've seen and I'm sending to the power people is the fact that as a community, we've always done it better. I am a healthy person because my community is taking a lead in implementing HIV led interventions. It is always better done by us, for us, with us. People in power, today we've shown you what we can do. We have shown you that we can do better because we have our power too. If you look at us, many of the people always talk about our communities, especially the criminalized one, as if we are not human beings. But in real sense, we are the people who are affected more. And this platform has shown me as a community person that we as community members can actually do it better. And nothing is more nothing is more difficult for communities if they do it together. So thank you very much. I am happy to be here. And we are happy because we have done it better. And the evidence is here in the HIV 2020. Thank you to all the global networks who kept this together. Thank you very much. Back to you, Rachel.
Thank you so much, Phelister. And the sex workers do it better. It's not a competition. I don't think it is a competition, though. We should make it a competition against the governments and the other technical agencies. So next, we do have Jeff Acaba. Jeffrey is a program officer at APCASO. He's supposed to be based in Thailand, but he's still stuck in Manila, Philippines. So Jeff is also the board member for GMP Plus. Jeff, without further ado, please.
Thank you so much, Rachel, for the introduction. I am deeply equally honored to be part of this panel of community leaders here at the HIV 2020 Closing Plenary. When the HIV 2020 was launched in December 2018, it carried the tagline, Reclaiming the Global Response. And let me share why I think HIV 2020 has delivered on this tagline. First, at HIV 2020, we have reclaimed ownership in generating evidence about us for us. We as people living with HIV and key populations do not just depend on governments, the UN, or academic institutions for data. Like what Phelister said, through our expertise and lived experiences, we drive research agendas, analyze data about us, and develop our asks based on evidence to recommend how things must be done effectively and efficiently. And with that, we have reclaimed the HIV response. Second, HIV 2020 has also allowed us to reclaim the driver's seat of the global HIV movement. From building solidarity across organizations and across layers of engagement to people living with HIV and key populations learning from each other's approaches and even challenging each other to rethink as we address difficult issues such as tackling harmful gender norms or defending human rights of populations criminalized by our governments. And for that, we have reclaimed the HIV response. Last but not the least, we have proven that when we, people living with HIV and key populations, are the ones leading the design, the content, and the delivery of a conference, it becomes more vibrant, more inclusive, authentic. And HIV 2020 may have promoted as an alternative community-led event, just like what Judy mentioned earlier, to run concurrently with AIDS 2020. But with the success and the innovations, HIV 2020 has set a standard of how future AIDS conferences should be done. And with that, we have reclaimed the HIV. Let me end by sharing that one of the things that resonated with me as a gay migrant living with HIV, attending the sessions of our online conference, was when participants are introducing themselves via chat. And I got to see the diversity of HIV activists and where they are connecting from. At a time when COVID-19 has separated us from each other, HIV 2020 served as a rallying point for us to reflect, to rekindle our lifelong commitment to ending the AIDS pandemic, and to also remind each other that we are still here. So warmest congratulations to organizers, to the donors and participants for a successful HIV 2020 and a meaningful World AIDS Day to everybody. Thank you. Back to you, Rachel.
Thanks so much, Jeff. Hope you keep well and safe in Manila. Next, we have with us Anton Basenko. Anton is working at the Alliance for Public Health and is based in Ukraine. He gave me a really, really extensive bio, which I will stumble trying to read all of it. But in short, Anton has a huge history and a lot of experience working in harm reduction, as well as advocating for hepatitis C, HIV, access to treatment issues. He's currently a member of the community's delegation of the Global Fund Board and is a global advocate of access to HIV treatment and harm reduction services among people who inject drugs. Over to you, Anton. Anton, I'm sorry, but you're on mute. You're not muted, but we can't hear you.
Now?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, it's important to say that I will speak not only on behalf of the Alliance for Public Health, but on behalf of the community of people who use drugs of the Eastern Europe and Central Asia region and Eurasian network of people who use drugs in particular. My sincerest congratulations and gratitudes to everyone who was involved and who supported us in creation of this conference. We did it. You did it. First alternate HIV community-based and community-led conference HIV 2020 is done. Now we definitely know that abstract system and borders are not a barrier. Short time framework is not the case. The time zones is not an issue. And what we've definitely learned that language is no longer a barrier. I'm really glad that conference has set the tone in the Eastern Europe, Central Asia region to find the proper resources for the translation. And these conferences really paid attention to online technologies and things like defending our personal data. We observed so massive diversity and quality of sessions. We learned really a lot. But the main challenge now is to find resources, experts, and to implement all this knowledge in practice, especially in times of COVID, especially in times when funding for communities is really limited and donor funding generally is reducing, especially in times when the civil society space is shrinking, especially when we are speaking about traditionally criminalized communities as people who use drugs in my region. Using this opportunity, I would like to raise some concern about the for the Dutch government, which traditionally has a huge commitment to support harm reduction and to support this particular conference. But our concern is that Eastern Europe, Central Asia region is not longer considered as a priority region for the further funding. Talking about the call for action, first of all, we should start from ourselves. You know, we are still not loud enough. We are still not active enough. I'm talking about my community, the people who use drugs in the Eastern Europe and Central Asia. Because to call other people to action, we have to be 100% active by ourselves. Talking about the conference, the only call is we are the evidence. It's impossible to make HIV services quality and accessible for communities without us. That means that every organization in the region or over the world have to take this obligation and do it on practice to hear community and work together to make HIV programs really effective. We know how to do, we know, and using this opportunity, I would like to share INPUD position paper in chat and invite you to support INPUD global campaign peers in pandemic, which taking place right now. We need really very little things. Our voice should be heard and start to be really influential. As a person living with HIV, as a person who used drug, living with disability in the Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and Ukraine in particular, I would like to say we are the evidence. Put communities first. Nothing about us without us. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Anton. And well said, nothing about us without us, and because we do it better. So next we have Najeeb. Najeeb Ahmad Fokeerbux is, sorry, about the pronunciation. He's the founder of the Young Queer Alliance, which is just based in Mauritius. He's also a board member at MPact. Since 2019, Najeeb has also been nominated to serve in the Community Rights and Gender Advisory Group of the Gold Fund to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria. So over to you, Najeeb.
Thank you, Rachel. Hello, everyone. It is an honor to join you all from Mauritius on this World AIDS Day for the final session of the HIV 2020 Online Conference to make our voices heard and in reclaiming the response to HIV as communities living with and affected by HIV. Among the many lessons from the COVID-19 pandemic, two things stand out for me today. First, when communities and science work hand in hand, countless lives can be saved and societies flourish. Second, even a small island country such as Mauritius can lead by example in being COVID-19 safe without leaving behind the most vulnerable members of the society when political leadership allows communities to meaningfully participate in the response. HIV 2020 has been a platform recognizing diversity and promoting inclusion. Black and brown people, women and girls, LGBTQI communities, people who use drugs, sex workers, and young people. Taking measure of where we stand in the global response to HIV, the lack of progress in reducing new infections among key population is driving overall failure to achieve global targets. Challenges in having services available at affordable prices and in accessible settings are real, the more so for key and vulnerable populations. During the HIV 2020 conference, as young people, we have shared our narratives and experiences in the face of HIV, including revamped activism, added community evidence to HIV programming, and young people as equal partners. Sadly, policy and legal barriers and lack of meaningful spaces for the involvement of young people in diverse responses to the global HIV response persist. In many settings, correct, consistent, and comprehensive information and the tools for HIV prevention and treatment do not reach young people who are vulnerable to HIV. Additionally, young LGBTQI people face physical and mental health challenges, socioeconomic burdens, bullying, violence, and family rejection, in addition to gatekeeper syndrome in accessing HIV services. Information, if shared, is often judgmental and not sex positive. These issues are hardly tackled when communities are not involved in and do not lead their programs. Moreover, at spaces where token representation of young LGBTQI people exist, the much needed resources do not follow. As we conclude HIV 2020, let us take with us the shared good practices and help in elevating the voices of communities affected by and living with HIV by acknowledging our experiences as communities, our contributions and strength, the achievements made so far, the partnerships we have built, and the programs we are delivering. Let us reclaim the HIV response. Happy World AIDS Day. Thank you. Back to you, Rachel.
Thanks so much, Najeeb. Next, we actually have Marcella Romero, who is an Argentinian activist and trans feminist defensor of human rights for the trans population of Latin America and the Caribbean. She's the regional coordinator of Red Luck Trans.
Mi nombre es Marcela Romero, soy coordinadora regional de la Red Latinoamericana y el Caribe de Personas Trans. Bueno, celebramos la clausura de la conferencia de VIH 2020. Bueno, las lecciones aprendidas que tuvimos en la población trans Latinoamérica fue la falta de recursos para poder cubrir el tema alimentario y los sistemas de salud para las personas trans. En primer lugar, reforzar las estrategias que hay en la región, las estrategias país y la estrategia regional, fortalecer y profundizar la agenda trans en Latinoamérica para poder acceder a todos los beneficios que necesita una persona trans en Latinoamérica. En este momento en Latinoamérica no existe el acceso universal y es necesario que lograr en todos los países que haya una salud integral para las personas trans y que podamos acceder a una buena adherencia al tratamiento y a todos los beneficios que tiene que tener una persona trans en Latinoamérica para poder acceder al acceso universal. Sin derechos humanos no existe el acceso universal al tratamiento, a la atención para las personas trans. Exigirle a los estados que cumplan las resoluciones que firman en la OEA el respeto y la identidad de género de las personas trans en los países donde no hay ley de identidad de género. La única forma que las personas trans podamos acceder al sistema de salud es que el sistema de salud nos respete nuestra identidad de género y que sean espacios sin estigma y discriminación. Los estados no cumplen las resoluciones y ahí es donde fallan los servicios de salud, donde fallan las estrategias y en donde las personas trans quedamos afuera de la agenda que tienen los países.
So we're going to move on to the final speaker. We're going to thank everybody who's participated so far, engaged in the Q&A chat, also sharing the video on Facebook, chatting with us as panelists and with each other in the chat function of this session. We have a surprise guest. He might not be a surprise to everybody, but right now I'm going to introduce to you George Ayala. George, could you please turn your video? George is, it's getting daylight there in where you are. He is now the deputy director of the Alameda County Public Health Department and was the former executive director of MPact, Global Action for Gay Men's Health and Rights. So over the last 30 years, Dr. Ayala has dedicated himself to promoting and protecting the health and human rights of disenfranchised communities worldwide. So over to you, George.
Thank you so much, Rachel. I'm honored to join you today on World AIDS Day 2020. I also want to publicly acknowledge our conference coordinators, the amazing Niluka Pereira and Rachel Ong. Thank you for your work. I know it was a big, big, heavy lift for you, and you did an extraordinary job. I also want to thank MPact, NSWP, INPUD, and GMP Plus, our remarkable translation team, and the thousands of HIV 2020 supporters and participants. Without you, this would not have been the success that it is. The decision that the International AIDS Society made to bring AIDS 2020 to US went against the recommendations of community advocates worldwide. Advocates repeatedly pointed to discriminatory legal entry restrictions imposed by the US on sex workers and people who use drugs. Restrictions that would have barred large swaths of our community from being able to participate in AIDS 2020. We also pointed to racist immigration policies and horrific human rights conditions for immigrants, Black and Brown people, and LGBT people since the presidential election of Donald Trump as reasons for avoiding the US. The debate surrounding IAS's decision to hold its 2020 conference in the US in many ways reflected a rift between duty bearers and rights holders in the global HIV movement, a misalignment of interests. Underlying this split is the fundamental question: who gets to make important decisions concerning our lives and our bodies, the lives and bodies of people living with and most affected by HIV? The answer, of course, is we do. This is not up for negotiation. As such, communities must continue to fight for meaningful inclusion, engagement as equal partners at all levels in all parts of the global HIV response. We need a global HIV response that respects and honors our lives, our bodies, and the issues that matter most to us. As such, communities must continue to fight for meaningful inclusion and engagement as equal partners at all levels in all parts of the global HIV response. We need a global HIV response that respects and honors our lives, our bodies, and the issues that matter most to us. A community-led HIV response necessarily devotes itself to racial and economic justice, gender equality, and human rights, including the specific rights of Black and Brown people, LGBT people, people who use drugs, and sex workers. These are interlocking issues that together influence the social shape of and the responses to HIV. These are the issues that matter most to us. HIV 2020 shined a spotlight on unfinished business in the HIV response. Those include unacceptably high HIV infection rates, hindered access to comprehensive HIV prevention care and treatment, persistent stigma and discrimination, and criminalization of HIV transmission, exposure and non-disclosure, drug use and possession, sex work, gender identity and expression, and homosexuality. HIV 2020 was an important opportunity to call into question business as usual in the HIV space, which we did. It was an opportunity to reflect, to critique, and to strategize in ways only we can. HIV 2020 was so much more than an important protest. It was also a call for a truly community-led response. We brought ourselves together in community to affirm and celebrate our accomplishments, our know-how, our strengths, our contributions, our programs, our partnerships, our relationships, and our power. We should be proud of what we were able to achieve. HIV 2020 was a remarkable show of solidarity. Comrades, we will need to lean on each other, and we will need to lift our solidarity as the single most important tool in our continued fight for human rights and health. Thank you so much. And I wish you a really safe and wonderful holiday season.
Thanks so much, George. George, you wouldn't happen to be wearing pants because we were making jokes before when you were still on the committee about a no pants, no problem party.
No, I happen to be wearing pants today.
Okay, so this is the virtual world. I'm going to ask all our speakers that have been joined us today to please switch on your videos as we say our final thank you and goodbyes to all the guests that have joined us today. So I'm just going to ask all the speakers to do that. So a final thank you to all of you who have joined us today. Just to let you know that this session is recorded and we will be putting in Marcella's intervention given that she's dropped off the line and we will be uploading this in the coming week. The HIV 2020 report is being finalized and it will be published by the end of this week. And you will also find this recording on live on Facebook. We want to thank the interpreters for all their hard work over the last 4 months, plus this session. To thank Niluka, who has been so bearing and patient with me and supporting the work that we're doing. I want to thank the co-organizers for the selection of Niluka and I, and also all the session co-organizers of all the 33 sessions that we've held in the last 4 months for your patience and your understanding, your dedication to the work that we do. So it's been a privilege, it's been a huge honor to serve you, to be part of this historical movement and moment. It's amazing to work alongside all of you for the last 2 decades in the work that I have been doing with HIV. And I'm continuing to learn so much from your passion, your dedication, your commitment, and most importantly, the action. Our voices are important and we are equal partners. Just a reminder to donors, we have 10 more World AIDS days to go. So keep safe, keep well, stay safe, stay well. Have a thoughtful and meaningful World AIDS Day. Bye-bye, everybody.